Okay, hi everyone. My name is Chirapak Supaipenan. I'm from Nipakao, from Thailand. Yeah.
Annyeonghaseyo. I'm Amulan from Nipakao, Sydney, Malaysia.
Yeah. Today we will talking about OpenStack networking at scale with OpenSDN or Tungsten Fabric for the multi AC. Today we have agenda, who are we, and the challenge for the multi-AC of a Nipah cloud, the challenge 1, challenge 2, and challenge 3, we will follow the more detail, and conclusion, and the open SDN community. Yeah. Okay, Nipah cloud is a cloud service provider in Thailand. We are the first cloud service provider. We start have a run the public cloud in 2016. This is the first cluster for the service. Yeah. And then 2019 we have deploy a private cloud for our customer like a banking or a telecommunication company. Yeah. And 2022 we have a new cluster. This is indicate OpenStack platform with the open SDN for the multi AC. We have three AC, yeah, and one is location. Okay, currently in the our production we have three AC and one DC. The first is a NCS BKK, this is in Bangkok province. Yeah, and second we have NCS Non, this is a Nonthaburi province. And third NCS BKK2, this is BKK province but inside the Telahau data center. And the last, this is S compute. We deploy in KKN, this means Khon Kaen province. Yeah, this is our production already. Okay, the challenge for the multi AC of Nipah. The first challenge, we need to separate the internet connection support multi ISP to each AC. And we need to control the in-gate or integrate is easy in and out, yeah. And we need to the reroute when we have some AC is gone down. It's reroute to the another AC automatically, yeah. And the challenge two, we need to single overlay network for the multi AC. It's made like AWS. User can have a multi subnet to ease the AC, yeah. And the last challenge, we need to support the connection like MPLS, SD-WAN, and direct connect, yeah. The challenge one, this is in the picture. I mean is we have a TAC, right? For the left hand side, this is some AC. We have a separate ISP connect is AC, and in the topology we will see the SDN. This is a open SDN controller to two node PM BTP peering with the physical router to control the in-gate and e-gate with the local preference or the AS part prepaid. This is an attribute of the BGP, right? Yeah. And then if we have some AC is gone down, the BGP is automatically reroute from the east AC from AC to each another AC. Yeah. This is automatic.
OK,
replace the previous challenges is about the public IP. When the one of the IP transits gone down, it's automatically reload to another AC. So it, the next is a challenges too, is a secret only network in regional and multi-AC. So there are cheap ways to connect like virtual network between AC. This is all about the private IP. The option one is a route target with a multi-protocol BGP. And second is an OpenStack logical router. And three, network policies. The third option is an operational route target. You have to put manually the route target into your virtual network. The next slide is an example. We have two AC right now, and this we need to communicate between the two subnet. For network A is a 192.168.2, and the next is virtual network B is .3. But we need two subnet is communicate together between not the same AC. From the virtual network A is in Bangkok. From the virtual network B is a Bangkok 2 in another AC that have 10 kilometers far. So we have to put route target into a virtual network, and then the route will be exchanged with the route target A will got the .3, and the route table B will got .2. So both of two subnet can communicate together after you manually put the route target. The next is the config on the OpenSDN web UI. After you put this, you will see the route target as already attached into the route instance. This one shows from the control node of the OpenSDN. You can pick the virtual network that you want to show the in the detail. So in the network A, you show the route of the .3. You will see the route target is already attached. And the same with the on the network B, the route target that :2 is already attached. So both of multi-subnet can communicate together. The next is the result from the network A. Before, the instance from network A will cannot ping to the network B. And after that, it will can ping each other. And for the option has, you can specifically choose the subnet that you want to communicate or subnet that you don't want. For example, virtual network A, you want to communicate with the virtual network B, so you have to put, just import the route target, the :3, so the router table A will get the :3. But if you want to communicate all AC, you have to put import all route target into your virtual network. For example, the virtual network B import :2 and :4, so in the virtual network B can communicate all the subnet in three AC. Okay, that's all for the first option. The second option is a logical router. The logical router, you have to create the router and attach the network. For example, you attach the network A and B together in the router. This is diagram it the same as the previous option, but it like you put the physical router one, and then you have the network A and B attached to the router. This is a config from OpenSDN web UI. You will see the first you create the router, and then the in the connected network you have to put virtual network A and network B together. So after that, the result is that A and B will can be together. This for the option two. And this when you show the route option, is the same as the pivot option, but the pivot option you manually put the route target. But this way, it works with the route target also. But the difference is the route target is auto generated. You will see in the board virtual network, we will have the route target that auto generated when you create the OpenStack virtual router. If you create the route target, the same as the network A and B have the same route target, so this board network can communicate together. Okay. And third option is about the network policy. Okay, I will show the example. Okay, this is a network diagram, but this way network policy have the three option. It is they have a board direction and in and out. This example I show you is about is the board direction. When you want your network A is point 2, right? You want network A communicate with the network B is point 3 in the network B. You have to put source from network A to destination network B. But if you don't shoot the board direction, you have to put switch the source when you want network B communicate back to the network A, right? You have to switch the source to network B and destination to network A. But this option, you create just one policy and apply to both virtual network. This how to create in a web UI and SDN. You have to first you create the network policy first, and then the source A and B. And next, you have to input the network policy into the virtual network. For example, this virtual network A, you have to input the policy of the network A and attach policy to the virtual network B also. Okay, after you put the route will link from the network B. For example, I show route from the virtual network A. You will see the network A is a point 2, right? But after you apply, it will leak the route of the point 3. So after that, it means the network point 2 can communicate, can ping to the network point 3 after you apply the network policy. This way is a result, but the difference is no extra route target is generated. It uses the import and export to route target each other. From the previous two options, we create the same route target with manually, and in the logical router, it generate auto-generated the route target and put the same. But this way, it uses the exchange the route target. And the next is how to check the detail in the routing in the OpenSDN web UI. You go to the control node and check the route, and you can choose any virtual network in your environment. And then when you choose the network, for example, this network A is will display all type of route such as BGP, XMPP, UDP, static route, and so on. But there are three options, but I cannot tell you which option is the best, but it's up to the requirement. Some customer use board method. Some customer use static route target bundled with the network policy. Some customer use just only the route target. The route target is easy to control, visibility, you can check it easily, but it requires the inventory, because if the customer A have route target colon 2, but you forgot and put the colon 2 into the customer B, it means their network will communicate together and it will be a nightmare for the admin, right? Because they don't want to communicate. So the next is the neutral router is native integration. Which means that you can create with the Neutron API. The Neutron API will handle the translation to create the virtual router in the OpenSDN. and it simplified because I actually I really love this way because the admin do not need to manage raw target. If you have the many customer like the 100, you have to inventory the raw target of the customer. And it have integration requirements because of its auto-generated the route target, which means you have to be careful because some route target you already use is maybe when you have used the same route target it may be wrong. And the network policy is has a compact processing because it have the on top is that access list on top of the routing, so it will be compact but more powerful.
Yeah, the last challenge, we need to support the validity of the connection to the VPC, right? Who are required this feature? Our customer enterprise company would like to connect the workload from the legacy, like on-prem to the public cloud, right? And they need to the privacy and security to the private service from the on-prem to the workload on the public cloud. Yeah, this is in the picture you will see the SDN controller and the physical router is BGP multi protocol BGP BGP is IDEA VPN is me the MPLS. Yeah, is we can connect per our customer specific the route target map to the subnet in the public cloud, out of public cloud. Yeah, when we map the route target on the physical server in the OpenSDN subnet of the our customer, it mean route exchange between the physical router and OpenSDN controller, and then the workload on the public cloud is can connect to the on-prem. Yeah. This is a example configuration on the physical router. Yeah, is the key point is we need to the map route target. Yeah. Okay, who are the network guy? Show me. who I know the open control tungsten fabric? Who I know? Okay, no. Okay, I left out something. Open control is a software defined network. It start with the Juniper. Yeah. And then migrate from the Juniper to the Linux Foundation is a rename to the Tungsten Fabric. Yeah, it's right now we change the VB fork from Git of the Open Tungsten Fabric to the Open SDN right now. We can join to the contribute or the use it. Yeah. Why we use the Open SDN? Because it's a three challenge, right? We have three challenge. The three challenge is compiled with the OpenSDN, like BGP. BGP is CAN, multi-homing, and ECMP part. If we have a two or three router, peering, route exchange with the controller of the OpenSDN is CAN ECMP packet by default. Yeah. And the single overlay network is we have a three option, right? In previously, we can use the route target, we can use the logical router of the OpenSDN automatically generate the route target to communicate between the subnet. Yeah, and the last is the network policy. This is a three option, right? You can choose map for your environment. Yeah, and the last is a wide connection to the VPC is a common of the network guide to the configuration. Yeah, it's simply for little guy, but it's not simple for the system or the developer. Yeah. Okay. I will show you the mapping the Amazon PPC feature to the OpenStack OpenDDL feature. Yeah. First is PPC similar to the project in the OpenStack. Yeah, and subnet is a main virtual network in the OpenDDL, and DHCP option is a IPAM. Yeah, Elastic something. Yeah, you can view see. Yeah, this is our feature right now. Yeah. Okay. I would like to invite some person to the talking about something OpenDDL community. Yeah. Yeah, ready? Yeah. Welcome.
Thanks, dear. My name is Randy Bias, so I have a long history with this software. I'm the community manager for OpenSDN, but I'm going to give you a little bit of background before we talk about kind of the community in more detail. So this code base comes from originally a company called Contrail, which was building this technology in 2012 was when they started, so 12 years ago. They're building this technology in that time, my OpenStack startup, which was one of the very first OpenStack startups. I was a member of the OpenStack Foundation board when it was first created, was integrating this technology into OpenStack in 2013, right? And then it was acquired by Juniper Networks, and they called it OpenContrail, and it was open source. And you know, a few years later, kind of fast forward from 2012 to 2017, or 2016, I joined Juniper Networks. And basically the reason I joined it was they were doing a very bad job of running their open source community. Like, it just wasn't working, right? They were thinking about it like an enterprise company, they weren't thinking about it like an open source project. So what I did is I took on doing a reboot. So I rebooted it, I renamed it to Tungsten Fabric, same code base, and then I got it moved into the Linux Foundation, so the Linux Foundation owned it. So then we started a process of kind of fixing the community. Things were going well, we had a bunch of people, but it was still largely a Juniper Networks driven project, right? It was mostly their developers, and there was always this constant tension as I was inside Juniper, where our customers would ask about adding new features, and Juniper would always think about those customers, they wouldn't think about the open source community. So last year, middle of the year, Juniper said, we don't want to do Tungsten Fabric anymore. And there's a lot more of the story there I can tell you at some other time in private about why that happened. But they walked away. And then the Linux Foundation felt that they didn't want to do anything more with Tungsten Fabric. So I came into the picture kind of late last year, and I realized there was this big community of people who were running Tungsten Fabric in production. And they didn't know what to do. Many of them had started to fork the software internally and make their own patches. They didn't have anywhere to put them because the Linux Foundation wasn't maintaining it anymore. So I said, okay, I've known this software and this project for a very long time. I'm going to fork it. First, I talked to the Linux Foundation. I tried to convince them to basically let me revive the project, but they wouldn't go for it. So I said, fine. So I forked it. I got everybody back involved. And then we started basically running on about February of this year. And we just released our first major release, production grade 24.1. Again, this is the same code base. This is running in production in big, big telcos, big, big enterprises. It's running at scale. When I went out and I started to talk to the community members, I said, why are you running this? Why aren't you running something else? They said, performance, scalability, this thing works. Works with the VMs, works with bare metal, works with containers. Like, it just solves my problems. So, we have been, thank you for that. We have been like really trying to get this community going, and it's cool, right? It's like, we're small, but like everybody involved cares, right? At the beginning of the year, there were 172 people in the Telegram channel. Now there's 237. I was just checking it. We had eight people joined in the last week. That's like 33-35% increase this year of people in the Telegram channel, getting there, talking to each other, asking about their health, trying to solve their problems with using the technology. So we're small, we go slower than some of the other projects, but we're built on this this really solid foundation of this code that has been around for a long time, is very mature, very stable, and we're very excited to basically let people know that we exist. Tungsten Fabric is dead, Contrail Fabric is dead, OpenSDN lives, long live OpenSDN. So what we did in the past year is we updated the code base so that we support all the latest versions of operating systems and kernels, especially for the vRouter, which is our SDN agent, which you probably covered.
Go ahead.
I covered this already. Like I said, just in the last, we're up at 237. Just in the last week, we added eight new people, right?
Go ahead. Is there one more slide?
No. Okay. So if you go and you look at the release notes for 24.1, we did a bunch of really great stuff, right? The idea with the latest release is to make sure that we have a stable base to start innovating on. One of the problems that we had was that we were running a lot of stuff that was dependent on Python 2, a lot. That's why we couldn't upgrade operating systems. That's why we had old packages. So we removed Python 2 from everywhere, right? We're 100% Python 3 now, big, massive updates to the code base. We started removing things that we don't care about, right? This is one of the nice things about Juniper not being in the picture, right? Because Juniper was about what Juniper needed. So we've done things like remove support for VMware vSAN, remove support for Mesosphere. Like, who uses Mesosphere? Nobody uses Mesosphere anymore, right? They had like one customer, Juniper, that was using Mesosphere, right? So we're starting to remove pieces of code from the code base that nobody uses and nobody cares about. So streamlining it, making sure we have high performance, making sure we have scale testing, which the NEPA Cloud folks have kindly given us a bunch of resources to do scale testing with. And we've established the stable baseline, right? So we modernized everything, and we're ready to go. So did you have the website on there? Yeah, here's the website. So opensdn.io, it's got a ton more information on it. It's got links to Discord, to Telegram, and to the documentation and the code base, of course. So we'd love to have you join, and thank you very much.